Can we have the music killed in the monitor? Thanks. All right, if you guys want to stand to your feet, we'll get started.
Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours. Mountain high or valley low, I sing out, remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. That I am yours, I am forever yours. Mountain high or valley low, I sing out, remind my soul that I am yours, I am forever yours. I am yours, I am yours. All my days, Jesus, I am yours. And I am yours, I am yours. All my days, Jesus, I am yours.
Love came down.
Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours. Mountain high or valley low, I sing out, remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours. Yours, I am yours. All my days, Jesus, I am yours. And I am yours, I am yours. All my days, Jesus, I am yours. Yours, all my days, Jesus, I am yours. I am yours, I am yours. All my days, Jesus, I am yours.
It is well with my soul. It's well, it is well with my soul. Christ has regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul.
it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. He's nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, Father, that we can say it is well with our soul because of everything that you have done. And we just thank you, Lord, that regardless of what has happened, Lord, the ups, the downs, the good, the bad, Lord, just like we sung, it is well with our souls. And for some in here, that's easy to say. For others, it's still difficult, Lord, because we're holding back. We are still doubting, trusting in you, Lord. I pray that you, by your Spirit, would help us in here to have faith, to continue to have faith, Lord, and to be able to say those words, it is well with our soul, Lord, regardless of what's going on around us, Lord, it is well. We thank you so much again for bringing us here this morning as your church, and we're excited to see what you're going to do. We love you and praise in your name. And everyone said, amen. All right, go ahead and have a seat. All right, look at blue sky. Did you guys smile this morning when you, oh man, it's brisk. It's brisk, but it's blue. I'll take it. My name is Andrew. I'm one of the pastors here. We have a few announcements. If you're new here, welcome. We want to get to know you, so please fill out a contact card in the back. You can put your name, your email, your number, and you can get on a list so that you're informed with what's going on here at the Bridge. If you want to meet with the pastors or have any other questions, you can put that on the form or on the card as well. And be sure, and I actually forget this every Sunday, to put it in the offering box, and we will go ahead and get that. Along with that, we also have new visitor bags as well. So we actually just restocked, so we have some goodies for you. We want you to take those. The bag itself is really, really cool, but there's some other really, really neat things in there. So if you're new, take a visitor bag. College group, tomorrow we are picking back up. We took a little bit of a break because of the Christmas season. We're meeting back up, so we're doing a kickoff, and the kickoff is happening at the bowling alley. So 7 p.m. we are going to Park Bowl. So if you have any questions about that, you can talk with me. You can talk with Nathan. I'm not sure if he is here. I think he is, but talk with Nathan, and we can get you some more information about it. We have a new volunteer lunch that is coming up on January 28th, so at the end of this month. So we talked about it last week. We'll talk about it again. With everything that goes on here on Sunday mornings, there's a lot of work that goes into to getting it ready, whether it's helping with kids or set up, tear down, music ministry, coffee, the whole deal. So if you're interested in serving, we definitely would love for you to be a part of that. So if you want to get some more information, be sure to be there. That's going to be January 28th. It's going to happen here, and it's going to happen outside after church, and we're going to be having a barbecue, so pray for good weather. That would be sweet. Growth groups are coming back again in February. So next month, we don't have signups in the back yet. That's probably going to start either next week or the week after, but you can sign up online. So I'm not sure if the web address is there. It's not, but you can go to actually not thebridge.com. What is it? Bridge.community. Jeez. Thebridge.community. Go to thebridge.community and you can sign up there. We have five or six groups this session, and you can get on the list before some of these groups close. And with all that being said, we are good to go for now. So go ahead, stand up, meet someone that you haven't met. We have a few new faces. Refill your coffee. Get a bacon maple bar before they're gone. We'll be back.
Which needs me to look. I need you to soften.
here still? Wow, they're all gone, huh? All 30 of them? Okay, there's some back there. Kathy just told me. All right, so this morning we have a special guest who's going to be talking about a ministry that I've actually heard about, and I'm not going to speak any more about it because Aaron's going to be able to talk about it better than I can. So we're going to bring Aaron up. Let's give him a hand, and he's going to talk about Engedi Ministries.
Thank you. Thanks very much for having me here today. It's a privilege to be here. I've been getting a chance to get to know Brian and Lynn over the last few years as they moved here, and it's been wonderful to continue that relationship, and it's awesome to see you guys grow and to see that you're in this place here. This is very encouraging, and so there are some of you that I know or have met, and a lot of you that I don't know. What I want to do is introduce you to a ministry that my wife and I founded and we direct. It's called Engedi Refuge. And this is specifically a ministry for women that have suffered prostitution or sex trafficking, and this is a restorative ministry. We literally do our tagline here. This is what we're about: healing the past, redeeming the present, and changing the future for those in society who have been the most oppressed and abused and dehumanized. Let's go to the next slide real quick. I want to tell you why. Jesus quoted this verse in Isaiah 61:1 about himself and his ministry. This is why he came. He said, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and to release from darkness," or the release of darkness for the prisoners. He was very specific about what he's about, and he's still very specific about what he's about. And he's intentional about accomplishing that through you and through me. And there is an aspect of binding up. This is what Engedi Refuge is really about, is taking people that have had a broken heart and providing some structure around their heart that to allow them to heal. It's about proclaiming freedom or speaking truth over people who have had lies and rejection spoken over them in dynamic ways that have shaped their life and crushed them. And this is about speaking the Lord's truth, and in that they become free from the captivity of lies and releasing them from darkness. They've experienced literal social darkness, but even more spiritual darkness that has kept them bound in a really phenomenal way. And Engedi Refuge is about releasing them from that darkness, and that takes time, and it takes a lot of intentionality. You know, Jesus also said in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, to some religious folks who were complaining that he was hanging out with Zacchaeus. Remember the short guy, tax collector that nobody liked? They didn't like that he's hanging out with sinners. But Jesus said this: the Son of Man, or himself, came to seek and to save the lost. He is very intentional about touching people who nobody else wants to talk to. And for us, God highlighted those who are prostituted and sex trafficked as, you know, we saw them as being rejected, basically, but nobody wants to be with them in society. And so we need to be, in obedience to Jesus, the hands and the feet. Let's go to the next one really quick. How do we do this? Engedi Refuge provides a restorative aftercare for victims of sex trafficking. There's a two-part component to it. This is a real flyby, you know, description of this, but I just want to pique your interest. There's two things. There's Engedi House, which is a safe house, and that provides safety, security, and a family atmosphere for women who need it. They have no resources when they come out of this kind of lifestyle or oppression. They have nothing but the clothes on their back very often. We provide a home for them. It's not a clinical atmosphere. It's a family atmosphere. The other component to it is that we have a separate location that's called the Engedi Learning Center, and there is a comprehensive program that's actually a three-phase program that is focused on trauma therapy. Lots of things that we do there. Talk to my wife later and find out lots of components there. But safe housing and a very comprehensive program. This is how we do it. Let's go to the next one. I want you to just know this, that relationship is key. People are hurt and abused because people hurt and abuse them. They're hurt by in relationship, they're also healed in relationship. And this is not just bringing lots of numbers through and someone is in a very impersonal way. This is a very person-to-person kind of ministry. We believe that this is key in ministering the kingdom of God to those who need it. Let's go to the next one. Teaching is vital. This is a picture of my wife teaching her life skills class. And there's a lot of stuff that has to go on in people's heart and mind. So you've got to bring up topics that are difficult that they need to face. This is a big component of the program that we're involved in. And let's go to the next one. And celebrating achievement. Another thing that we do with these ladies, they've experienced failure and been put down and put in a box of failure and rejection, if you will. And we celebrate achievement. We give them lots of affirmation. And we even have ceremonies that celebrate their achievements as they work to bring themselves to a healthier place in life and to work on their sobriety and all the issues that make them vulnerable to something as horrific as sex trafficking. We celebrate their effort. And so that's Leah at a celebration ceremony. And let's go to the last slide really quick. What we're about is communicating to the body of Christ what God has built and what God is doing in and through us, and building church partners. We have partnered with many churches across Whatcom County. We want to continue that relationship. We want to grow that relationship. What we're hoping for is the church as an organization, each church as an organization would find some way to partner with us. And there's many ways that churches can do that as an organization itself. And individually, we're looking for what we call faithful 500 donors or faithful 500 partners. That many individuals, we don't have 500 yet, but we're targeting 500 faithful individuals or families who would say, this is important, this is a Jesus thing, and I want to touch a prostituted person with you and help redeem them and save them and bring them out of that pit. So consider that. Just quick plug. We have information at the table in the back. Leah and I will hang out in the back and talk to you. I'd love to answer your questions. So that's what I have. God bless you.
We should have just had you preach the message. I could have given you the text we were doing, and you could have rolled right into it. That was awesome. Okay, while I get set up real quick, hi. If you guys have your Bibles, why don't you grab them, open them up to Philippians chapter 1. You ever like go to put your password on your computer when you really need it to open and then it doesn't work? And then you go through the, which password did I use for this? No? Okay, just me. All right. My name's JJ. I get the privilege of bringing God's word this morning. And for those of you guys that are new, I've seen some new faces the past couple weeks. That's awesome. Welcome. We're glad you're here. We hope somebody said hi to you. If they didn't, hi. We are stoked you're here, and I just want you to know that even if it's your first time to church ever or in a while, that God knows you. He sees you. He sees you when you're all by yourself. He knows the things that bring you happiness. He knows the things that hurt your heart, and I pray that God would take his word that we're going to study this morning and would reveal himself to you through it. So what we do here at The Bridge is we are a Bible church. We believe in the Bible. We believe that it is the living word of God. And right now we're going through a series titled Joy through the book of Philippians. We started last week and Brian preached, and it was a great message, I thought, if you guys were here. I know you agree with me. And we're just going to go verse by verse through the whole book or the letter of Philippians. It was actually a letter. So what I want to do is I want to read our scripture this morning and then pray. And then I have 5 points from the text in Paul's life that talk about joy. What is it? How do we use it? What it does and who it's from. So I want to talk to you about joy this morning in a way that has really It's been a great reminder for me, and I think it'll do the same for you. So let's read this. Philippians, if you have a Bible or an app or any way to get the word, we're just going to read right through it. So you can even take it home with you when you're done and keep on reading because it's good stuff. Chapter 1, verse 12 is where we're going to start, and we're going to go through verse 18. Okay, so 12 through 18, chapter 1. It says this, verse 12, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Yes, and I will rejoice. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the truth and the grace and the power of it. Lord, you tell us that if we give you our ears and our hearts, you will speak to us. You will seek me and find me when you seek for me with your whole heart, your word says. So, Lord, I just speak that over this church right now, that we would say, here we are, Lord. We want to hear from you. Open up our ears, open up our hearts to receive truths from your word. In Jesus' name, amen. The title of my message this morning, because it helps me to think if I can put stuff in like a working title, it kind of helps me to filter everything through. So I've titled this morning's message, Joy, an Atmosphere Changer. An Atmosphere Changer. Because Paul, who is writing this, and I realize that we hear that name Paul all the time, and many of you guys may not even know who he is, what he has been through, what this letter is writing is all about, but it's really helpful to know some of that background information before we start breaking down what it is that he's talking about. Paul was a Christian. He was a follower of Jesus. As a matter of fact, he was an amazing church planner. God had gifted him. You ever met someone who's really gifted in what they do? Maybe a trade or worship, music, whatever. But you meet him and you're like, man, this person is like, they were like made for this. Well, he was kind of like made for planting churches. But it didn't start out that way. Before he was a good church planner, he was the guy that they called to shut churches down, to shut Christians down. He was like the dude that got called in to give the yay or nay, whether someone should live or die. That was Paul. He hated the church. As a matter of fact, it tells us in Scripture that he hated Jesus ultimately, because when he had this radical conversion in his life, he said, who are you, Lord? And Jesus is like, I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. Like, all this stuff you're doing is against me. It's because of your hatred for me. And he's saying, it's really difficult, Paul, for you to kick against the goads. Like, it's hurting you. It's hurting me. And Paul had this amazing, his name was Saul at the time. He had this amazing life-changing experience. From that experience, have you guys ever heard of Paul's three missionary journeys? It's these things, if you have a Bible, check it out. Go all the way to the back of your, if some Bibles have it. If you have like one of those sweet Bibles, they have, definitely have it for sure. What is sweet Bible? If it has a leather cover, it's a sweet Bible. If it's a hardcover, that's cool too. If it's like a study Bible, that's a sweet Bible. But if you turn to the back, they'll have maps. You ever wonder what these maps were for? They're for a purpose. They're not just a place to stick the bulletin from church and then forget about what day the next thing is going to be on. I've never done that. Okay, so there's maps in the back, and it says Paul's missionary journeys. Paul is known for these three journeys that he did that took 10 years. Roughly 10 years, these three journeys took, okay? We have recorded history about 30 years of Paul's life. From Paul's conversion to when he died, he was actually beheaded, had his head cut off. Which I was thinking about this week, and the Roman Empire, when they killed him, was like a nice way to go. The bad way was to be crucified like Jesus. But the nice way was quick and easy, beheaded. And anyway, so Paul was beheaded. We have about 30-year window. In those 30 years, Paul went all sorts of places and all sorts of stuff happened to him. But at the end of those times, he ended up getting arrested. And he's writing this letter to a church that he had planted years prior from a jail. He was in prison in Rome. He actually, his sentence was house arrest. So anybody been under house arrest? Raise your hands. So he was under house arrest. What does that mean? Well, it says at the end of Acts, where if you read any of these, I'm going to give a little bit of background because it's so cool. If you read through the latter half of the book of Acts, it follows Paul's life, and you see he goes to some of these places. And then these epistles or letters, he writes back to these churches to say some stuff. The letter of Philippians is a thank you letter. It says, rejoice in joy like 15 times because he wants them to know he's in a good place. As a matter of fact, he's super hopeful and full of joy for what God has done, redeemed the past. Say that again, redeem the past, something the present. Come on. Change the past, redeem the present, heal the past, and change the future. That's killer. I'm going to steal that. Hashtag that thing. So that was Paul. So he writes these letters. He actually wrote four letters from this jail. He's not in a jail cell. Like in Philippi, he got arrested, chained to the wall, got beat within an inch of his life. We'll get to that. Bad prison. This one, people were able to come and visit him, this and that. House arrest. But here's the deal. He was chained to a guard 24/7. All the time. What about when you have to go to the bathroom? That's when I think. They were there. That'd be weird. But that's how it was. 24/7. 6 hours a day to the gnarliest guards of the day, the Praetorian guards. You ever seen the movie Gladiator? You know the part where Caesar comes out into the ring to face Maximus at the end? You know what I'm talking about? And then the guards come out around. That's the Praetorian Guard. They were like the secret service of the day. They were the gnarliest, most highly trained, most fierce warriors. That's who these guys were. Paul was chained to one all the time. Four a day. Six, 12. Four a day. 6 hours apiece. And he writes this letter from this place. He actually wrote. There are four of his letters that are called the prison epistles, okay? So there's Philippians he wrote from at this time in jail, Colossians, Ephesians, and then this little one called Philemon. But if you ever read those, that's where these were written, from this place in his life, towards the end of his ministry, when you would think things would just be popping like crazy because he had done so much. He's actually chained in a house under captivity, and yet he is writing a letter about joy. Not only that you can have it, but it exudes from him as he writes. And so as we look at these words that he is saying, we have to understand where he was at physically, spiritually, and emotionally as he's writing these things. To me, it's helpful. Hopefully it is for you. So I have five things about joy I want to move through. Let's look at verse 13. So that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. First thing about joy. Joy is a rampart. Do you know what a rampart is? It's like a really cool word for saying a defense mechanism or a wall. Defense mechanism is dumb. I just made that up. It wasn't even in my notes. It's more like a wall. Like, I was talking to Evan and Lindsay last night. They were just on a super sweet 3-month European vacation adventure. Everybody likes you a little bit less now, but they had fun, and there are lots of castles over there. And we were talking, these castles all have some sort of wall around them that protects. It's to keep the enemy out. Did you know that joy is like that? Joy is a rampart. It's a wall that is built around your heart that is there to protect you from darkness and evil. See, Paul said in all of these things, this has happened, but everybody knows that I am in this place because of my love for Jesus. It's become known throughout the Imperial Guard and to everybody else that I have stood for this, and this is why I'm in this place. It's because of Jesus. It's because of his walk, the things that are important to him in his life, and him standing up, that he is in this place. Even though Paul was in prison, there was something that could not be taken away from him, and that was his joy. I always think about Braveheart, like the most famous line ever. They can take our this and they can take our that, but they will never take our freedom, everybody says. But it's like that. You could take this, you could chain me up, you could take away my freedom, you can take away this, but you cannot take away from me who Jesus is, what he has done, and what he wants to do. And that put Paul in a place of intense joy, to where he could write to these people and he could say what he is going to say throughout the rest of the letter. So be prepared to get your mind blown by the cool stuff coming up. Number one, joy is a rampart. When do you get this? When does this come into your life? At the point that you surrender your life or give up your life to Jesus' control. Galatians 5:22 is a verse I want to check out. It says this, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Just before that, if you're reading in Galatians, it says, we all have this thing. It's called the flesh. It is a bummer. But we have this thing of spirit. It is awesome. The flesh and the spirit, it's like a civil war inside of you. Because we don't do the things that we want to do. And we do the things we don't want to do. And they're at war against one another. And then it says, now the lusts of the flesh are evident. And there's a whole list of, and you read, you're like, yep, 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 yep. And you read them all and you're like, yep. They deal with all that. And then afterwards it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. These are things that are given by God. Love. You ever notice how after you surrender your life to God and you just are like, Lord, my way has been wrong. And I don't know your way exactly, but I want to have joy. I want to know that there's future for me, that there's hope for me, that my past doesn't define my future. It simply brings me to the present so you can lead me from here. We all get to that place as people. If you're walking with Jesus, we all came to that place. We were like, this way's not working. I don't know everything about God and Jesus and all this stuff, but I know that he says that he loves me and has a plan for me, and he lived the life that I can't live to give me a future that I could never get on my own, and we surrender our life to him. At that point of surrender where you're like, I am yours. I am forever yours, like we were singing. These things come in because the Holy Spirit comes into your life. You get downloaded joy. You ever see Matrix where Neo was like, when he's like took the red pill and all the stuff, and he's like, I know Kung Fu. I know, I say lots of movie stuff, I'm sorry. I like movies. Because I can relate to them. I can relate to Neo because I am the one like him. But he says, I know Kung Fu. And then Morpheus is like, show me. Remember? Because they put in the thing and he's like. Okay, so now we know love. We have to work it out. How does this love work? But we have joy. Well, where did this joy come from? You know, you can't work for it. You can't earn joy based on how much money you make. What kind of car you drive won't bring you joy. How good you are at snowboarding. I tried that. The find my joy at how good I could be at a hobby that I love. But when you look for your joy in something that isn't really good at giving back to you, you find real quick that maybe something will bring some short-term happiness, and it will. But it can't fulfill what God was only designed to fulfill. And when things don't give back, they just take, 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 those don't guard your heart. They callous your heart. But joy is a fortified defense system that guards our hearts from evil and darkness for the believer. So now that we know what this is and how we have it, let's move to the next thing. Number two, joy is tested. Oh, you have a rampart, do you? That's nice. Let's see how it handles against these fireballs. Oh, it withstands some fireballs. Let's try whatever else you would shoot at a wall to blow it up. Let's set up some ladders and have some people hike over it. Let's see if we can dig a hole under it. Just because we have this thing doesn't mean that it's not tested. It is tested. Look at verse 12. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, comma, that what has happened to me, I skipped over that for the first, like, I don't know, day and a half of study. What has happened to me has really turned out. We'll get to the part where he says what it has done, but what has happened? What has happened to Paul up until this point to where he's saying these things that have happened to me? Give me an A. Problems. Paul said, the things that have happened to me. I could go on forever because I love Paul's life. Because to me, he's like, the dude was, I want to have the type of joy and tenacity that Paul had, because he would not take. He just, man, he said later on in Philippians, or later on, I wanted to preach it this week, but Brian will do it next week. For me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. That's like mic drop. When you say that, you're like, I'm out. Obama's got nothing on that mic drop. You walk off stage, because for me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. That was like his whole life. That's awesome thing to say. How does someone get to that place? Joy is tested. Paul wrote this in 2 Corinthians, because I could talk about them all on myself, but he actually wrote this. Four verses that talk about what he had been through. 2 Corinthians 11, 24 through 28. You go back and check these out on your own later. It's crazy. So Paul says this: 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews 40 lashes minus one. That's a nice way of saying 40 lashes was supposed to kill, was supposed to be enough to kill you. 40. So they would take one off because they're so merciful. They would take 39 lashes. It happened to him 5 times. Not like at once, on 5 separate occasions. Talk about a messed up back when he took his shirt off. You know what I'm saying? 5 times. Okay. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. And he didn't get stoned because he was lashed or beaten. It wasn't like that, Washington State. Stoning was, sorry, I told myself I was going to throw a stone joke in there. It didn't land good. Stoning was a death sentence. It was a death penalty for Jews. Crucifixion, beheading, death penalty for Romans. Stoning was the way that you were killed at the hands of, it was like the death sentence for Jewish, for the Jews. So, 1 time he was. So, it wasn't like some people picked up and threw some rocks at him. They actually killed him once he was stoned to death. Paul died. It was on his first missionary journey before he had ever set foot in Philippi, before he had ever planted this church, about 2 years before, in this town, this city called Lystra. He died. And you imagine being one of his guys that was traveling with him when that happened? Like, he's kind of like our leader and stuff. What should we do now? And God brought him back to life. And he got back up. What did he do? He walked back into the city that he was just stoned from, because he was a man on a mission, and he had something that he wanted to say. There was a joy that needed to be communicated. And you could take his life, but you couldn't take his joy. That's what he means when once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. Three. This guy is horrible at traveling. A night and a day I was adrift at sea. He was actually on his way to Rome, where he is in prison. He was in a shipwreck. I have a friend who's a pastor who's a surfer, and he says that he can prove that it was the first time in the Bible people actually surfed. Because if you go back in Acts, and he's joking, sort of, but if you go back, it says that the ship broke apart and that they grabbed every piece of wood that they could and they rowed them to shore. He's all sea surfing. Did you know that that time it says that Paul himself, go back and check it out at the end of Acts, where it says his journey to Rome, it says he lost all hope. He says, and when we had lost all hope of living, and then it continues on. There was actually a point where he was like, that's it. He had been through all this stuff, but there was actually a time where he had lost all hope. I was, a day and a night, I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, in danger from rivers. I don't know what that means, being in danger from a river. Don't cross here. Danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, in toil and in hardship, through many a sleepless night, in hunger and in thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure, and apart from other things, oh, and one more thing, there is the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. I do believe his rampart was tested all the time. All the time. You know, we talk about Jesus being in the desert, he was tested for 40 days. And Satan came and tested him for 40 days. And then it says, and then after that, Satan left and the angels came and ministered to him. Satan left until an opportune time. Oftentimes we think that like, oh, he passed the test. Satan left him alone forever. No, I don't think so. He probably left him alone for a second. And then he was right back the whole time. You know, he's not an enemy that like is chivalrous. Oh, you dropped your sword. Pick it up and let's duel some more. It's like, kick him when he's down is his tagline. And he never stops trying to take your joy. Oh, really? This brings you joy? Well, what about this? Well, what about that? And that's why we have to understand this great and amazing gift that we have. One of those beatings was by a jailer in Philippi who became the third convert in that church. You know the letter he's writing? The first three people that became members of that church was a fashion like the Mugatu of the day. Lydia, the seller of purple. She was a fashion icon. That's what she did. She was in the fashion industry. She sold the latest gowns for royalty. She's the seller of purple. It was the color of royalty. She was way up fashion industry. Second one, a demon-possessed girl who followed Paul and them around for days, yelling stuff at them. And finally, Paul had enough, and he turned around and he cast the demon out of this girl. But this girl had a spirit of divination. She could read, like psychic style, right? She could like read palms or tell people stuff that was coming down the line. And her bosses, once they saw that she was no good to make them any money anymore, they got really mad. And they're the ones that got Paul thrown into jail in Philippi, where this jailer beat the tar out of him within an inch of his life, chained him to the wall, and then Brian talked about it last week. Paul and Silas, they were singing in the jail, singing songs. You're like, dude, you are crazy at this point. And they're singing songs, the jailer, and then there's an earthquake. Earthquake comes, their chains are come off. It was a miraculous thing. And the gates were opened, and the guard woke up because he was sleeping on the job, and he was about to kill himself because for a Roman guard, if your prisoners escape, you die the death that they were supposed to get. and all these people would have died, so it would have been a bad day for the jailer. So he goes to kill himself, and Paul's like, don't kill yourself, we're still here. And something about Paul's life leads this guy to come rushing in, fall down at his knees and say, what must I do to be saved? Something about the life, just in that short time that Paul and Silas, their influence, caused this person to come in and say that to them. And then that dude who just put all of those lashes on their body says he took them home and he cleaned them up. He cleaned their lashes, and then him and his whole household gave their lives to Jesus. This is the Philippian church. They were a mess. Kind of like us. They had all these backgrounds, all this stuff they had done. They had hurt people. Yet they experienced joy and forgiveness. Their past was redeemed. God did own them and did have a future. And Paul did not want them to lose that, because this life is hard and we have to encourage one another. That's who he's writing to from jail. Maybe it reminded him, like, dude, this jail is nicer than when I was at such and such's house. Man, I miss that guy. And he's writing to them. He remained joyful while he was writing this letter. Do you ever feel like everything or everyone is against you? I do sometimes, man. It's like everything that I touch just falls apart. And you just feel like you're under heavy fire all the time. Well, your rampart is under attack. I heard this week, and I like the way it was written. Spiritual maturity can be measured by what it takes to steal your joy. Spiritual maturity can be measured by what it takes to take your joy away from you. And I will never be a guy that throws my family under the bus from the pulpit, but I'll tell you this, it's easier to take a 7-year-old's joy. Actually, he's pretty good. It's easier to take a 9-year-old's joy sometimes. Like, why do I get the yellow bouncy ball instead of the blue one? Day changed, right? Spiritual maturity, hopefully, I am a little better. I still get upset sometimes, but do you understand what I'm saying? It's something that happens over time. Hopefully when my boys are 25, they're not going to be as mad about the yellow bouncy ball situation. They'll have moved on to something else, and it'll still be their brothers. God bless them. We should pray for them right now. They will always have things that they go at each other about, but hopefully it will grow. And that's what I want for me and what I want for you. That's why this verse helps. 1 Peter 4, verses 12 and 13. Peter writing, another Christian who had been through tough stuff. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to what? To test you as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share in Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory revealed. Don't be so like, what is this thing happening to me? It's very normal. You're under attack. Jesus said it like this in John 16:33. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. You're going to have some problems. But take heart. There's that word rejoice again. Take heart. I have overcome the world. Joy is a rampart. Joy is tested. Next thing, we'll move through. Joy gives proper perspective. What do I mean? Verse 12, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me, life has problems, check out this last part, has really served to advance the gospel. You ever notice when things in life are bad that you like sit down and reweigh priorities? Like when stuff is going good, you're just cruising right along, no big deal. But when stuff comes in and kind of catches you by surprise, or big life events, near-death experience, a loss of a friend or family member, loss of a job, going to jail maybe, getting fired from your job, these are the things where you like stop for a second because you just got the carpet ripped out from under you, and you kind of like reassess. And joy, if you maintain joy, it gives you such a radical, proper perspective on life, on what is going on. And so Paul's perspective was this. Through all of this stuff that has happened, it actually has really served to further the gospel. He's not like, dude, this place is everybody else's fault but mine. I was just trying to do the right thing. For the last 10 years, I've given my life, given my blood, given my sweat, given my tears, given my friends. And I've done this, and all this stuff has happened to me, and now what? Here I am in stinking jail again. This is my life. This is my lot. You know the opposite of joy is bitterness. It is the opposite of joy. Bitterness is... So how did Paul do this? How did he not turn bitter, but remain joyful? He didn't focus on himself. Because all that stuff did happen. All that stuff really hurt. But his focus wasn't like me, 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 me. What was his focus? Jesus. All of these things have really served to move this forward. He focused on Jesus, not on all the bad stuff that had happened to him. That's a tough thing to take in, because it's hard. It's hard. It's hard to take the focus off of your hurts and put them on the greatness of God. It is a tough thing. But let me tell you something. It is worth fighting for. Because one direction produces joy in your life. In the other direction causes you to close off from everybody, from the world, and do the exact opposite that which God has called us to do. Philippians 4:8 says, and now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. We'll get to this in a few weeks. Fix your thoughts on what is true, what is honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about these things that are excellent and worthy of praise. We need to remember what Jesus has done for us, and that will give us the joy. Because you guys, the Christian life, it wasn't meant to be lived inward focused. It was meant to be lived outward. That's why Jesus says, don't worry about these things. Here's what the world worries about. How much money am I going to make? Am I going to get some new denim pretty soon? You know, how is my car looking? Do I look the part? He's like, everybody's worried about that. Look at the birds. They're not worried about that. Doesn't mean that they didn't do anything. They were gathering, but they weren't worried about, is this going to be a tough winter? Am I going to have work this winter? They were just doing what God had put in front of them. And he says, how much more do you matter than the birds and the flowers of the field? Those flowers, they're more beautiful than anything on this world, on this earth. Yet winter comes and they're gone and they'll be back next spring. How much more valuable are you? Therefore, do not worry about these things, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added, because God knows what we need. And that's a freeing thought. We'll bring it in. Joy is attractive. Notice Paul's life has an effect on three different people around him. It's become known through all the whole imperial guard and the rest, so two, and everybody else, that my imprisonment is in Christ, and it's done a couple things. It's made, in verse 14, most of the brothers, having become more confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word. Some do it out of love, some do it out of selfish ambition, but joy is attractive. I wrote this, a joyful response to life will get noticed. You ever heard the term, we're going to make an example out of you? Maybe you haven't. I have. I had a judge speak to me one time, and it was a long time ago, people. But he said to me, I'm going to make an example out of you. And I was like, oh, crap. And he did. But I was thinking about this week. If there was an example of ridiculous amounts of, like, somebody just throwing the book at you with love and grace, that's what Jesus wants to do with you. I'm going to make an example out of you. Oh, yeah, this has happened. That's happened. You've done this thing. You've done that thing. Look what he did to Paul. Oh, you were the guy that was like single-handedly trying to shut down the church and kill all these people? I'm going to make an example out of you. You're going to exude joy and encouragement to others. It's not improbable, it's impossible without God doing it. Jesus said, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill can't be hidden. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket. Therefore, let your light shine so before men that they will see your good deeds and glorify your Father who is in heaven. What does that mean? It means let the way that you live, the way that you do your day to day, be an example. And people will see that. You are an atmosphere changer. When somebody knows who they are and where they're going and to whom they belong, that attracts others. We can see from Paul's example. You will bring out the best in some. You'll bring out the worst in others, unfortunately. Some people were bold. You ever see somebody that does something, you're like, man, that's just a normal person. And God's like using them to do something. Maybe he would use me if I would like just go for it. Brings out the best in some. Brings out the worst in others. I would have had that promotion if he wasn't hanging out with the boss after work all the time and you know, it's all this stuff. That should have been mine. How come all this bad stuff happens to me and this person just gets all the good stuff? I hate that person. Our focus is totally off. But if we can keep our focus right, it brings perspective and it gets noticed for sure. And last but not least, true joy is from God. Look at verse 18. What then, Paul says, only that in every way, whether in pretense or truth, that Jesus is proclaimed, and in that I will rejoice. As long as Jesus is the one that people are focusing on, he says he's good with that. Not only did he not go back at these people that were talking shade on him and smack on him, but the very last thing that we have written from Paul was a letter to this dude named Timothy, who is another pastor who was younger than Paul, didn't have the experience, but he wrote to Timothy and he told him this. Do your best to present yourself as God, an approved worker who is not ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth, but check this out, but avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness and their talk will spread like gangrene. Don't be someone who is known for how the word for our church in this is don't be a church that talks about how every other church does it wrong and you do it right. I take that. That's the word for our church. The word for me personally, don't be someone who bags on everybody else to make yourself look good. I don't do that. I just critique their actions to other people. No, you're talking smack. And that's what we do. We talk smack on other people so people think that we're smarter or cooler or more godly. Paul's talking to Christians. Some people are preaching the gospel out of selfish ambition or conceit, rivalry, trying to stir people up, being like, oh, well, they're watered down or they blah, blah, blah. He was like, that's a joke, Timothy. Have no part in that. Here's what you do. Focus on Jesus. Love people. Live with a purpose. Live with joy in your heart. That will get noticed. That will get noticed. Don't worry about this other stuff. Be about the Father's business. And I like that. So maybe you, like Paul, feel chained right now. Something. I don't know what it is. And you feel sorry for yourself. And maybe rightfully so, because it's hard. All I can think about is this. Maybe you're exactly in the right place. Maybe you're right where you need to be to have the biggest impact on the world around you. Paul probably could have thought of 100 other places he would have been more useful. Instead, some of the best work of his whole life was done in prison, chained to a guard, talking his stuff because he couldn't write. He had bad eyesight. Maybe they chained his writing hand. But what did he do? He spoke it all out loud. 24 hours a day, someone chained to him, hearing truth, seeing the way he responded to situations. at the end of the book, he'll say, oh, and by the way, all the people in Caesar's household that are saved now, they say, what's up? It has an impact. Jesus said this, these things I have spoken to you that in me, excuse me, these things I have spoken to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. It's good stuff. Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for your word. We sing these songs now as a response to your goodness and your grace. Lord, joy is something that is from you. We can't manifest it on our own, but we by faith can believe that you have put it there. Help us, Lord, to live that life of faith, to know that it's there. You want to use it. You want to make a difference, Lord, in our town, in our city, in our state, country, and in the world. We need that joy, Lord. We ask that you would stir it up within us, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. Oh, you are forever mine.
And Father, as we continue to worship you in the act of giving, Lord, we pray, God, that you would multiply the finances that are given back to you, Lord. And I pray, God, that we would be able to just give joyfully to you, God, knowing that everything we have on this earth, including our bank account, Lord, is all yours, Lord. And we pray, God, that you would, like I said, just multiply what is given, Lord, so that your name would continue to be preached and taught and spread throughout our city, our county, and throughout the world. We love you so much.
You guys will stand with us for this last song. Just really meditate upon the words of how great the name of Jesus is. Lost or saved. Savior, defender, you are my King. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us.
Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Redeemer, Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, Defender, you are my King. Redeemer, my healer, Lord Almighty, my Savior, Defender, you are my King.
Thank you guys. Have a great Sunday.